right.
The cockroach cheerleader.
One of your biggest cheerleaders, that's for sure. Well, thanks.
So how are you doing, sister?
I'm doing great, Rich? Tonight. Doing good. I know you're always talking about great and exciting things. I missed a little bit of it, but caught the last, and it is great that you've got so many people coming from so many places for the film festival, so I'm certainly pleased about that. But we are talking again tonight. We're talking Cowboys, and we're talking Texas Rangers. We've talked about some Marshals and other Cowboys in the past, but tonight for Western Legends, yesterday and today, we're going to be talking with author Johnny Baker, Jr. Johnny has a book called Burn Alive in Gumption Junction. So this is all about Texas Cowboys in the 1800s, a little bit of Civil War, and kind of some things that happened after that. And so just wanted to share that with our listeners tonight.
Okay. Well, Mr. Baker's online. I just turned his mic up, so you can go ahead and say hello to him. He's listening to you. He's ready to go.
Okay. Hey, Johnny, thanks so much for joining us tonight on the show. I told him we
were
talking about cowboys and outlaws and a few other good things about Texas history tonight.
Thank you so much for this opportunity. I'm very excited to talk about my book.
Well, sure. So let's talk a little bit. Let's just start at the very beginning. Did you always want to be a writer, or were you just interested in the subject and then you started writing, or how did that come about?
Well, I have always been a writer, but I've always just written for myself. In fact, occasionally I would share things with one or both of my parents, but mostly, I just wrote for fun, and then I got into college, and I had a good background with high school English, so I went ahead and studied English throughout college and studied history throughout college, and I finally came to a point here a few years ago where I decided I wanted to share something that I wanted to write with other people besides just my parents, and the result was Burn Alive in Gumption Junction.
Okay. Well, tell us a little bit about the story. So it's about pretty much German Jack Fordham, right, who was tell us about it. He started it, I guess, does the story start there in the Civil War, or does it kind of start in his current day, and then it goes back to some memories?
Yes, ma'am. The main character, German Jack Fordham, he's a fictional character. The background story is all historically accurate. I was a history teacher at one point in my life. So I wanted to make sure this book was historically accurate. The story of German Jack in the foreground is a fictionalized account, though. And what happens in the story is these men, these Texas Rangers, this close-knit group, have been riding together since the Mexican War throughout the 1850s and even into the War of Northern Aggression. And then they are forced by Reconstruction after the war, they are forced into hiding because everything in the South is against the law now, including the Texas Rangers, which had existed in Texas since it was Mexico.
Right.
So these men that go into hiding, and then something from their past, something from the 1850s, comes back to them, and they are forced to protect one of their loved ones. They have to come out of hiding, And that's what drives this, that's what drives the story.
Okay, great. So it's a little bit of a history lesson. It's a little bit of a love story. It's a little bit of revenge and hope and redemption. And Ed will like this. I guess one of the lines was he had a Colt in one hand and a Bible in the other.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
That might be the next opportunity for you. So keep that in the back of your mind, you know, when you're reading this story.
These are all good, godly men who are trying to do what the Lord wants them to do. But just as all people, you know, especially when you're dealing with bad people, sometimes you have to do bad things and you have to say bad things, and that also works its way into the story. I tried to write these fictional characters as realistically as possible so that everyone could identify with them.
Right. Okay, great. Well, tell our listeners where somebody could get a copy of the book. What's the best way?
Well, the best way for the listeners of your program to get the book will be to go to Amazon and the book Burn Alive in Gumption Junction by Johnny Baker Jr. is available on Amazon in both paperback and Kindle format. And also something else that I'm very proud of is the fact that the book is the only novel for sale here at the Texas Ranger Hall of Fame and Museum at Fort Fisher in Waco, Texas.
Okay.
And
yeah,
I'm very proud of that. Other book is nonfiction. Mine is the only novel because the history is that accurate.
Right. Okay, great. Well, so that's the thing. So tell our listeners a little bit about what's the hardest thing about writing?
Well, gosh.
Was it the research? And you kind of love that? So was it just sitting down and actually doing it? Or was it getting published? Or is it the marketing now?
Well, there are difficulties at each stage. For me, as a writer, the thing that was hard is just getting started. Just like anyone, anything out there, you know, I had done different things through my life, and I had pushed this idea of writing, and I had pushed it off and pushed it to the side and held it at bay for a while, and then I just kind of painted myself into a corner where writing was the only thing that I had to do, that I could do, and I resigned myself that, God, this is what you want me to do. I need to sit down and write this book. And really, once you get started with writing, if that's what you like to do and what you want to do, and especially if you're conquering this fear of opening up and sharing it with other people, once it gets going, that's really easy. Now, in the process of the writing, I never gave any thought to what came after it was written, because my life dream and my life goal was writing this book and getting it out.
And getting it written, sure.
Right, and I'm thrilled that I've done that. To me, as a writer, that is a victory.
Right, that's right, it is. Yeah, and any kind of writing, you know, short or long, but novels especially, because that's a long form of writing. And so it takes dedication, it takes perseverance, and it takes commitment and a time, you know, to spend that time to research and make it, you know, like you say, you want it to be as accurate as possible. And we talk about that a lot on the show. We talk about how, you know, a lot of times people misrepresent the truth, you know, to suit their purposes. And so the real stories, the true stories, sometimes don't get told because these myths are created. And then those myths kind of take over and become people's reality. We say that, you know, it's a shame that fiction is fact for a lot of people, when in many cases, you know, that's not exactly how the story was. That's not the true story or the complete story. Maybe it's part of the story, but not the complete story. And especially as it came to, you know, to other cultures and women and things like that, we just know that movies and other things kind of took some license in how they represented people. And so for you to come along, for people to write the accurate history and stories and be so authentic, you know, that's a really key thing, and that's really important to us, me as a publisher, me as a writer, as an author, and as a radio host, you know. And part of the thing we do on the show, we call it Western Legends Yesterday and Today, because we want people to know their history. Because if they don't know their history, then they're not connected to it, and they're not as impassioned about it, and they don't get up in arms when it gets threatened if they don't know anything about it. So that's why we like to tell those stories. And so even though it's a novel form, we really appreciate that, you know, the accuracy of the history that you spent and the time that you spent to do it that way. So kudos to you for that.
Throughout my study of both literature and history, I came to an interesting realization, especially once I was charged with teaching history here in the community college system, which I did for a while. I came to the realization that when you look at a history book, it's fine to study the history, but you also have to be aware of what was going on at the time that the book was published.
Right.
Who published it? Who paid for it? What was that attitude? But when you look at literature or painting or sculpture, any kind of art, you find what people felt about the era and what they believed and what their hopes and their dreams were. And that, to me, I've often found to be more honest and more realistic than so-called history books.
right, exactly.
Which is why I didn't have any qualms about deciding to write a historical novel instead of an historical textbook.
right. There you go. So the story set in the kind of from the 1840s up through kind of through the War of Northern Aggression, as we call it, those of us in the South. For those of you in the North, maybe the Civil War is what you've heard more than other parts of the world. And then it goes after that and into that, and I'm trying to create lives for themselves, and then, like you say, having to come back out kind of that, of retirement and hiding to face some foes. So we hope that you'll check that out, that you'll go to Amazon. Johnny's name is spelled Johnny Baker. That's J-O-H-N-N-Y. Baker, B-A-K-E-R, Jr., J-R, and the story again is Burnt Alive in Gumption Junction, available on Amazon. So let me ask you, what's the greatest thing about writing the book, and besides getting the book published and in your hand, what's the next best thing about being a writer?
Well, gosh, the best thing about being a writer is to know that here is this story that I have told, that I have put certain things into this story from my academic education to my life experience, things that I know have gone into this book. Mm-hmm. And for me, the great thing about it is knowing that there might be people out there that have a shared interest or a shared background who might be able to get the same things out of it that I put into it. But yet, even better than that and more amazing than that, and something that I didn't even really think of until after I was done with the book, is that somebody might be able to read the book and from their experience that I might not be at all familiar with, they can get something out of the book that I didn't put into it.
Right, right. Yeah, and, because we all bring our experiences to whatever we read or whatever we see or whatever we watch, whatever we hear. It's all filtered through our own personal perceptions and knowledge. And if we're open to learning new things, then it's amazing what can happen. And it's amazing how connections get made and how you meet people that, like you say, you never would have met. We haven't met personally, but we've met online and we've met through phone conversation. And so, you know, now we're connected through our love of history and through our love of writing and through our love of publishing. And that just expands out to other people. And I think, you know, for me, publishing is all about the storytelling. Because like you say, the heart and the soul and the feelings come through storytelling. And those are heart things and not head things. And I think that we've gotten away from some of those things, and I think that's a detriment to us in our society and the fact that we've kind of gotten away from some of that. And you know, in any way that we can move back toward that, where we can share our stories and see the similarities that we have amongst ourselves, then that helps us move forward together, you know, instead of not together. So. And that's a big thing for us is for Sisters in Harmony, is that we want to bring people together from all over the world. And literature and art and music and books, that's what brings people together, regardless of their language, regardless of their culture or their customs or their, you know, what they know. Sometimes that breaks down the barriers, don't you think?
Sure. But having said that, I do hope that people who are not familiar with or need to be reminded of the wonderful history that we have in Texas, particularly with the Texas Rangers and the Frontier, hopefully people can be reminded or be introduced to our wonderful Texas history in reading this book. That is something that I do hope everyone gets out of it, because that is interwoven throughout the background of the entire story.
Uh-huh. Right. Look, yeah. And that's the thing, and there are so many people that don't know. You know, they may have heard the name, or they've heard Texas Rangers, and they think baseball teams or other things. But, you know, but there's a whole other group of people who, like you say, ordinary men who risk their lives, you know, to you know, proceed with law and order across the Western Plains, across the Western Territories, Texas especially, and New Mexico, and all the way over to California and up north, and all the way across, you know, Kansas. And we've talked a lot about Buffalo Soldiers and things like that that came in after the war, and we've talked about, like you say, some of the marshals that were in the Indian territories and things, looking for outlaws and things. And so it is a proud history, and a lot of people, like you say, they just don't know. And so it takes books and things like that and literature for people to be able to get a better understanding of what was going on and the customs, and the fact that you've kept the language and you've kept the descriptions and all of those things and the places true, you know, to what they actually were, you know, is a real, you know, consideration and high calling for the book and for people to read. So like you say, they're not just getting the entertainment value, but also the educational value as well. So. So that's great. So is this, the first in a series, or have you got some other books that you're writing, another book that you're writing, or are you just in the process of trying to promote to get this book out?
Well, the answer to that is yes. I would like to write another book or even two in this series with these characters. I definitely know that the second book that I write is going to deal with this same central characters getting into the buffalo hunting and the Indian wars and circumstances that would arise as the result of those experiences as well, and I'm definitely looking forward to figuring out how I'm going to do that. I'll have to see what the characters tell me and how they want me to proceed.
Well, that's what I was going to say. So do the characters take over once you start? Sometimes that happens too. Did that happen kind of in this book?
That very definitely was the case in writing this book. My protagonist, German Jack, his personality, he came through to me even before it was on the page, because he wanted to get this story right, and sometimes he was patient and sometimes he was not. German Jack, you know, he has a lot of integrity. He's a man of great character, but you know, patience is not really part of his character.
Right. That's a strong suit. Yeah, but he suffers a little gladly. Well, a lot of times the secondary characters, too, you know, that you just intend for them to make an appearance, and then all of a sudden they keep showing up, you know, and you go, wait a minute. I didn't really have that in mind, but all of a sudden they're there, you know, and you kind of sometimes you have to go where the story takes you. So that's the other thing
exactly.
I think about writing, is that, you know, the surprises, the things you least expect, and like you say, and there's a lot of that that comes with the polishing and marketing when you're out, you know, promoting your book, the opportunity to talk with people and to hear stories of people's ancestors, you know, of people's great-great-grandfather or their uncle, or, you know, great-uncle or their, you know, their aunt or their mother or grandmother or somebody in the family, you know, that experience, had some kind of experience. You know, my grandmother came across in a Conestoga wagon. She can remember, you know, being scared with the, you know, the wolves howling and being afraid it was Indians and things like that. She was the oldest and of four siblings, and so, you know, she felt like she had to protect the rest of the kids and all. But, you know, it's to actually have lived some of those stories is great. And what we tell kids today is to go find the oldest person in their family and ask them about the stories that their grandparents told them so that they don't get lost, because there's usually one person in the family that's the historian, and when that person, something happens to them or they die, a lot of the history gets lost because there's nobody else to, you know, take it on. So
and I have to say, I have to say, since you mentioned that, that was another thing that has always driven me with my writing. My grandfather's brother was sort of a second grandfather to me, and when we would go out to our farm in Mineral Wells, which is on the other side of Fort Worth, we're coming from Dallas, we would always listen to Uncle Ovid tell stories about his childhood and about his youth. And it got to the point where sometimes he would tell the same stories every time.
Right.
But every single time he always told a story that we'd never heard before.
Uh-huh.
Right up to the last time he went with us to the farm, he told a story that if he hadn't been with us on that trip 2 weeks before he died, a week before he went in to the hospital, if he hadn't been with us on that trip and told us that story, he would have died without us knowing that story, because it was the only time we ever heard that story. And I dedicated my book to my Uncle Ovid and to also to another cousin of mine who was very encouraging to me in the writing process as well. And I think that that's a very important part, too, is to remember who brought you there and who helped you, and to share that with everyone.
Right, that legacy and that, yeah, and that connection, yeah, for sure. Well, I hate
yes,
it because, ma'am. You know, we only have 30 minutes for the show, and so our time is up, but hopefully we can have you come back again and talk more about this, or maybe another story once you start writing that. But let's tell the listeners again one more time. It's Johnny Baker Jr., and it's J-O-H-N-N-Y, Baker, B-A-K-E-R, Jr. The book is Burnt Alive and Gumption Junction. That's B-U-R-N-T, Alive, A-L-I-V-E, N, Gumption, G-U-M-P-T-I-O-N, Junction, J-U-N-C-T-I-O-N. And that's available at Amazon.com. in Kindle format or paperback. And so, Donnie, we thank you for being on the show and sharing your inspiration with people. For the writers out there, we hope that they won't let anything stop them from writing their stories and publishing their stories and sharing their stories with others, because sometimes that's the hardest thing, isn't it? You know, we're kind of afraid to share our stories with other people. But once we do, it's not nearly as scary as we thought it would be.
No, it's not. No, it's not. You just have to get out there and do it. Thank you, Liz. Thank you all so much. And God bless y'all.
Do you have any questions for Johnny before he says goodbye?
No, I don't. I just want to thank him for coming on. I know our next guest is waiting in the queue, but I just want to thank him for sharing about his book. Thank you so much, sir.
Well, thank you, sir. Thank you so much, and I look forward to coming on next time. God bless you.
Okay.
Take care.
We'll see you on the show.
Okay, God
Thanks
bless.
Thanks so much.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Okay, good night. Good
Thanks,
night.
Sir.